this evening. Tim Brando alongside Spencer Tillman as we get ready for Texas and Iowa State. The Longhorns head coach, Charlie Strong, in his second season, got a critical win against rival Oklahoma in the Red River Shootout a couple of weeks back, looking to get his team even at 4-4 on the campaign. And now in his seventh season, Paul Rhodes, who grew up in nearby Nevada, Iowa, only 10 miles away. He was actually born there, grew up in Ankeny, both towns so very close. This means so much to him, truly a dream job, and he's hoping that his team can deliver some much-needed W's to this very gracious fan base that they have, and patient one as well. And the opening kick to Wilkes will go through the end zone, and Iowa State, who did get the ball by virtue of Texas deferring, will take over at the 25. And let's get the three things we need to know, Spencer, when they have the football.
Well, first of all, you got to force Texas to defend four options of one formation, and you do that by establishing the run. And you also have to have a high completion percentage. Anything less than 60%, Timmy, you're not really selling yourself like you're committed to passing the ball. You've got to make it count when you do throw it. And then that leads to the third and short scenarios. If they can do the two aforementioned, Iowa State, they can put themselves in a good position.
Mike Warren, the freshman sensation, is in the backfield. He's rushed for just under 800 yards on the year. He gets the first carry, and that's going to be a real key against this stout Texas front. He gets 6 yards on the opening play as Joel Lanning. 3 touchdowns last week, a beautiful second half in the rain in Waco, Texas, but this is his first start.
Well, he is starting for the first time, but the thing I like about him, he has all the temperament that they need, that Paul Rhodes is looking for to make this team go to the next level. He simplified some things offensively. Mark Mangino is no longer here right now, so we'll unpack the implications of that as the evening progresses.
Troops formation to the top of the screen. Dangerous pass as the route was being jumped. Pass intended for DeVario Montgomery. Duke Thomas had a real shot at that one. 3rd and 4 coming up.
Well, Montgomery's got to be able to complete those passes and catch them. That's what we talked about in the three things that Iowa State needs to do. You have to be efficient in the pass game to at least give the impression that you can throw the football if you need to.
They go with 4 wides and a setback. That being Warren out of the gun. Swing pass. Look at that closing speed on Warren coming from Peter Jenkins, 19, the senior linebacker, who had snuffed that play out very quickly.
Jenkins did a nice job of closing again, and this is identifying exactly what Charlie Strong likes out of his defense, to be able to be the ability to pursue from the inside out and run from sideline to sideline and run and chase. That's a hallmark of a Charlie Strong coach defensive unit.
Colin Downing will punt it away back deep. Dajay Johnson, senior, number 2 in the Big 12, with just under 16 yards per return. This one's low with its trajectory. Does get an Iowa State bounce inside the 32-yard line, and that's where the horns will take over after a 38-yard boot. And, Spencer, the three things we need to know when Hookem has the football.
Well, you know what Charlie Strong told us. First of all, they want to mark their territory. It's really about the identity and the power running game. Get 4 yards on first and second downs. Jay Norvell, the play caller, told us that's got to be a premium for him. And, of course, the quarterback, you must pressure the field. That is, if you're running in the middle, pressure there. To the perimeter, to the outside, put stress on this defense across the board.
Jonathan Gray is the setback. Johnson goes in motion. Here goes Gray. Head to the 37-yard line. We would like to welcome those of you that watched the conclusion of the Oklahoma victory over Kansas. Tim Brando along with Spencer Tillman. Second play from scrimmage for Texas after a 3-and-out for the Cyclones here in Ames, Iowa. The Iowa State Cyclones and the Texas Longhorns get together. Dajay Johnson is knocked down quickly by Jordan Harris as Hurd, trying to swing it out there, looks at a loss of 3.
Jordan did a fine job of doing the first thing. Fundamentally put yourself in a position to make a tackle. Nice job to opening and set the tone for this Iowa State defense.
3rd down and 7. Hurd lost his footing for a moment. They did a nice job of bracketing him there with that pressure. Levi Peters, 35, the junior from Gilmore City, Iowa, making the tackle on the elusive Hurd.
Well, Levi Peters is one of those hearts and souls and spirits of this defense. First of all, it's about the pressure breaking down. You're going to see Levi, number 35, come in the backside and make that play right there. Tremendous job of pursuing and finishing the play by Levi.
Michael Dixon will punt it away now for Texas. Trevor Ryan is one of their version of Dexter McCluster that they have here for Iowa State. They'll use him all over the field today, including here on special teams. Lightning quick. Gets it up to the 30-yard line where he is ushered out of bounds. 43-yard boot, 4-yard return. We are just underway on FS1. Nothing to nothing here at Ames.
Yeah, they got a shot. Who knows they got a shot? Oh, what is wrong with you people?
Looks like Strahan got bozoed on Halloween, huh?
Apparently homie does play that.
Second and 11, Joshua Thomas in the backfield. They swing it out to Trevor Ryan, who's tripped up just past the line of scrimmage by Devontae Davis, number 9. Negligible gain, perhaps a yard. We'll call it 3rd and 10. And you see they're carting off the right guard, Daniel Burton. Yeah. Wendell Tayese has come into the game. They'll go a little deeper into that proud senior-laden offensive line as the evening continues without one of their better pass blockers now. Lanning, his first start ever at Iowa State, decides to tuck it. This is the element he brings, and he should have a first down.
That's a tremendous job of pulling the ball down. They bailed out, did the Texas Longhorns, in an effort to kind of confuse him. Lanning just came down, and it was scary, but he worked his way out. Devontae Davis missed on an open field opportunity there, and he works to Lanning upfield to get extra yards. That's a nice job by this record-setting quarterback for the Iowa State team.
And you see Duke Thomas now coming off the field. He got banged up as he was going low to make that tackle. He just made the necessary yardage to move the sticks. And you see the numbers on him against Baylor. It was very impressive enough. This was not a shock that he took over. The fact that Mangino philosophically had some difference of opinion and vacated his position at offensive coordinator was the story of the week here. Not so much that Lanning is starting. We've been getting plenty of playing time. Pocket beginning to break down. And again, he keeps the play alive, and that's the difference that he brings. DeVario Montgomery makes the reception. Sam Richardson, the fifth-year senior starter, will go down historically as one of the top quarterbacks in Iowa State history. But Lanning gives them just that.
Statistically, he is one of the best. He will go down as statistically in the top three of quarterbacks that have played in the history of the program. Jay Campos, the left tackle, did a great job of helping to extend that play.
On second and one, a little mix-up that time on the pass to Montgomery. We're trying to go bubble screen there. Lanning went more with a dart on what looked to be an out pattern.
Yeah, DeVario, this is the second opportunity he's had. And again, it's really about those finer points, Timmy, the execution. That's what they thought they're going to get out of this quarterback. And again, if they don't get it, it's going to undermine exactly what Paul Rhodes wants out of this offensive unit. And it's part of the reason, and he won't say it, but I think we can, is one of the reasons why he wanted to go to this style of approach.
Third down and a yard to go. Negotiating those short, choppy steps just enough as he burrows inside the 45-yard line for the first down.
Mike Warren, one of the great stories here. Again, tremendous job. If you look at the offensive coordinator that's behind it right now, Mark Mangino put the offense together now. But what they want to do with Todd Sturdy is go to a more controlled, ball-controlled, and a very efficient passing attack. And that's what they're trying to get here this afternoon.
I got to tell you, I thought he was excited about his opportunity to call plays for the first time as maybe his quarterback was to start, as Alan Lazard, a big, tall, rangy receiver at 6'6". We've got a marker down, a very late flag thrown in an area where you'd suspect holding.
Number 72, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Timmy, I think what Todd Sturdy was really excited about was the fact that, look, he's a former receivers, quarterbacks coach. He's worked with the whole bunch, and to be able to see it all come together in one time, I think that's what he's really jacked up about, because he sees the bigger picture. It's about having the consistency to make it all come together is Joe Lanny. You see him working against the pressure out there, getting to the edges, trying to stress this Texas defense.
Shiro Davis clearly held there, number one. And that brought on the flag, so it's first down and 20. Trips formation to the top of your screen.
Texas playing a conservative look here, playing zone behind it.
Lanny finds an opening. Past the original line of scrimmage and then some to the 40-yard line of Texas. Peter Jenkins, number 19, the senior from Dallas Skyline High with a stop.
Dylan Haynes in there as well, working to the backside, but it wasn't until a significant game right there for Iowa State.
Well, you see they're going tempo. This is what Sturdy wanted. Quickness. That ball is dislodged on a super hit by Devontae Davis against Alan Lazard. That was a laser thrown to Lazard, but after he got popped in the chest, the ball went out.
Well, Davis missed twice, but he didn't miss on that one. I mean, that was just a strike right there. Lazard got that one. He'll remember when he goes to that outcut next time.
Third down and six.
Texas again standing a cover two look with the high safeties back here, Timmy. That's all about being conservative.
Andre Daly, 13, has checked into the game.
No games and deals up front.
Nice. Beautiful shallow cross. That's Clinton Bundridge inside the 25. A first down. Jason Hall, number 31, with a tackle.
Joe Lanny with tremendous poise on that play. A games and a deal working up front. He took advantage of it. He's got this team tempo and pace getting back for another strike.
First and 10. Iowa State on the move. And now you can see so much of why Sturdy was so excited as they go tempo and try to get this big, brawny pressure. Texas defense tired. With a curl pattern to Daly. Bondray Daly inside the five.
Well, Davis slipped on that particular play. It's been a mixed bag for Devontae Davis playing that left field corner position. He didn't have an opportunity to recover in time enough, and Daly made him pay for it, Timmy, with great athleticism and poise and bringing that ball in to get the extra yardage.
They mark it at the 3-yard line, first and goal. Lanning is now 4 of 8 for 47 yards. They're going a power look. Warren's got it into the end zone. No signal yet. Touchdown. He got it.
Freshman's third touchdown of the season. And again, you can see he's not afraid to stick his nose in there and go and get it, even on an inside zone play against this vaunted front of Texas. Historically, Texas is going to really always field a significant front. This year, the group is pretty talented, but he just ran through.
Cole Nutton will try for the extra point. Austin Fisher will hold. Very effective drive culminating here. It took a while for them to signal touchdown. And I don't see anything there that should change things. It's where the ball is located when the knee hits the turf. And he appeared to have gotten through. But they always check every score. Nutton's extra point is good. Joel Lanning, sophomore from Ankeny, where his head coach grew up. Handed off to Mike Warren. Over 800 yards on this season for the frenetic freshman. And the Cyclones are pumped and have the lead.
Well, if you're into predictive statistics, this is a ghoulish stat for you, Timmy. When Charlie Strong doesn't score first, they're at 9-1. When they don't, alternately, it's a different outcome. And maybe the flip side of that would be that, of course, this same Iowa State team scored first against TCU and came out on the short end.
Yeah, they had a lot of fumbles, too. They had control of that game for 2.5 quarters. I mean, they have been very close. Their head coach told us the last 40 minutes are the best 40 minutes they've played. Now, they don't have a W to show for it. But this could be their seminal moment tonight. That kick comes down to Dajay Jackson, short at the 15. And he is hammered at the 22 after an 8-yard return. And let's take a look, Spencer, at the Nissan Heisman watch.
Who do you have this week?
Well, I'm still sticking with the pocket guy, and that's Leonard Fournette, the running back at LSU. He's got a big one coming up against Derrick Henry and the Alabama Crimson Tide. Boykin really showed us something the other day. They even made Data Holgerson come over and slap him five after an outstanding run. And then Christian McCaffrey at Stanford, man, he's sneakily getting into that mix.
Yes, he is.
I think that's one of the teams to look down the stretch. But for now, it's Leonard Fournette's show to have.
I loved what Dana Holgerson did. He said that Corey Coleman was the best player in college football. And then after the game with TCU, he said, wait a minute. I'm going to abstain on that for just the moment. I think Boykin might be the guy for me now. Jonathan Gray in the backfield. And it's Hurd on the keeper. Ahead for eight, maybe nine. Stopped by Kawan Floyd, number seven. Young man playing through a hamstring injury. Second leading tackler on this team.
He's playing through a handful of dirt, too, in his helmet there. But it was a nice saving tackle there by Floyd. Nice read by the quarterback as well.
Saw the cast on his hand. He's got a broken hand, too. Gray turns the stretch play back up, gets the first down to the 35 for Texas. Willie Harvey, 16, one of the many freshmen that you'll see on both sides of the ball playing for Iowa State. Redshirt freshman out of the state of Florida making the tackle.
And Jonathan Gray is going to be one of the smaller backs Texas will field out there today. They are a power running team, Tim.
Those statistics show you all you need to know how they've changed the script. Dajay Johnson off the sweep.
Texas reverse.
On that reverse, gets it out to the 44-yard line. Nigel Tribune shoved him out.
Yeah, Nigel in good position. This is what we're seeing here, putting pressure on this Iowa State defense. Jay Norvell, the play caller for Texas, says they're going to try to stretch the field both vertically and horizontally with some of these types of moves with a three-formation set.
On second and two, Hurd decides to keep it this time, has another first down to the 46-yard line, and he's stopped by J.D. Wagoner. If the name Norvell sounds familiar, it should. He had been at Oklahoma. Now he's calling the shots for this Texas team as you look at Wagoner making the play there for the Cyclones.
It's been a number of years ago, but you remember the old hats, Will. In 2007, he was calling plays for UCLA and had to stop at Nebraska as well.
Gray, just shy of midfield, gain of about four. Willie Harvey making the tackle again, very active in this game. Counterpart for Norvell is the grizzled veteran of the South, Wally Burnham. I've known him for 30 years, and he said when he got here, I'll coach for three or four more years. I've already got my retirement elsewhere. And he's been coaching 3 years beyond what he thought he would, and he's done a marvelous job putting these players in the proper position. Jonathan Gray ahead for a couple, and that's it. Iowa State defensively stout up front with Jordan Harris, number two. This kid is very tough, a real ringleader for Wally Burnham's defense.
And Wally, as you talked about him being on his second act, he's actually got a son on his staff that's consistent as well. He's trying to create another generational approach here for these.
That'll keep a lot of old coaches gainfully employed when they've got young coaches as sons.
Nothing wrong with it.
No, not at all.
Trips formation up top, Timmy. Single receiver look to the field.
Nice. Hurd pressure and sacked. Back at the 45-yard line. Coming off the edge, Levi Peters again.
Sam Peters again. It's a reoccurring theme. Number 35 is going to show up. The pocket is going to collapse. He comes underneath here and avoids a couple of would-be blockers. Levi does a nice job of sifting through that front to find his target.
Dixon will punt it away after the loss of six. Trevor Ryan back deep, standing inside his 15 and calls for a fair catch. 5:44 remaining opening quarter after the 44-yard boot. Iowa State out to a quality start. They've seen this act before. Can they sustain the success over four quarters? We'll find out about the next series in a moment. 7-0 our score. A reminder, our Fox 4 is always delivered on Sunday evenings. Yours truly and Spencer Tillman, a part of that 13-member panel. And that's our current four. Any issues with those, Spence?
Not at all. I mean, look, Leonard Fournette, we already talked about him with Heisman. We think that team should be right now. But Ohio State's issues right now, Timmy, are problematic for a couple of reasons. We can sit here and unpack that all day, but I don't have any issues with where they are right now. We didn't penalize them last year when they were down to their third quarterback. So
yeah. Well, it was shocking to learn that JT Barrett was obtained earlier today. And will not be playing next week, as you see Mike Warren getting ahead to about the 15 when they play Minnesota. By now, I'm sure you've seen the documentation on that particular story.
Well, I think the thing that's disappointing about that, Timmy, is he's the leader. I mean,
yeah.
He just newly installed in that position, and he disappoints you in less than a week.
That was the shocking part, that and the timing of it all. On second and six, Warren, already a good start for him, something they needed to do. And since September the 19th, this young man has been right there. Look at that. We're talking about two Heisman front runners, and Warren, the freshman, is right there behind them.
He's so productive, and as a young player, you don't expect that, Timmy, but that's part of the discussion that we had in talking to Paul Rose. He says usually when guys get here in that freshman and in that second year and third year, they're pretty strong, and then something happens where they fade and they get settled, but he didn't think this guy has it in his DNA. Warren is a top-notch player.
Third down and four. Landing again flush from the pocket. He's at his best when he gets flushed from the pocket, and there's Lazard again, Urbandale, Iowa's own. Very physical receiver at 6'6".
I like the way he moved the pocket there and just found him open. Joel Lanning surveying. Jason Hall was in a single safety look behind him, nowhere even close to it. So number one, the quarterback did a fine job of putting the ball where it could be caught and away from the safety where he couldn't close on it and take the angle away.
Spotted at the 31-yard line. First and 10.
Texas still playing just a four-man front. Resigned to play zone behind it. Now they're showing pressure.
In effect, it was a run blitz with a quick slant pattern thrown to Daly, and it falls incomplete.
Well, that's what you want to do. You want to beat the zone blitzes, and if they are a straight blitz, if you got man coverage on the perimeter, you got to be able to beat it.
Lazard, by the way, that last catch, Spencer, got him over 1,000 yards in his career, 1,014 in his career, and that's not bad considering he's only in year two. Second and 10.
Safety creeping down for Texas. Pressure look.
Throwing off his back foot that time and incomplete, intended for Jawan Wesley, number 10. Young man with nine catches in 2013.
You can see the pressure, Timmy. This is where it's coming from, all over the place. And then Lanny did a nice job of just getting that ball away there under duress from the Texas entire front four.
Third down and 10 coming up. They've stayed away from third and long for the most part since that opening series.
Showing another pressure look. I don't think he's coming, though. He's bailing out. No safety help.
Backside pressure. Look at him dance and prance away from the pressure. Yeah, you got it. That's something you can't teach. Just a beautiful ad-lib move by Lanning. 18 yards and another first down.
Jordan Harris helping him there on that particular play. You can see him move and get to the perimeter of the boundary and out chase those big hogs on the defensive front. And again, Lanning doing a nice job of getting there himself. But here's a nice block right here on the perimeter, Timmy. That sets him free for an extra 7 yards.
Two rushes for 28 yards for Lanning. And we've got an injury. Looks like Hassan Ridgeway, 98. He is a very strong leader for this defense. Vocal leader.
But along with Desmond Jackson, yep, and Hughes and company at 6'3", 314. He's a centerpiece in what they're doing up front. Very physical, pocket pusher. The type of guy that can be very disruptive. There are a couple of ways that you can affect offenses. One of them is to change where the line of scrimmage is established. And that's what Ridgeway has been able to do for them effectively.
Well, a reminder that once we're done here, more football coming. It's been day long and evening long. We'll take you out to the West Coast. Rich Rod's Arizona Wildcats take their high-powered offense into Seattle to take on the Huskies. It's all right here on FS1. Well, you talk about cannibalizing. How about the Pac-12? I mean, really, it's Stanford or bust, you would think, from a national standpoint, although Utah would have an outside shot. USC was getting national love for perhaps reclaiming their elite stature, but they've already lost three times.
You know, everybody's talking about the obvious surprise. UCLA's collapse kind of for me is really, I know they lost Miles Jack, but I really thought that Coach Moore really had them headed in the right direction from their scheme and everything they were doing, but today they were playing even too close to the best.
Yeah, barely held on to win against Colorado at home after getting a big lead. Well, Ridgeway is coming up with some assistance.
That's a big boy right there, 314 pounds, and Ridgeway
as I said, is the centerpiece of what they're doing. When he comes in, and they've got a heavy rotation in that front four, trying to keep all of them fresh. But he's a big key to what they're trying to do and trying to affect the offensive line.
First down from the 49. That's Joshua Thomas. He's bigger, stronger than Mike Warren. Different kind of back, but he's showing steady progression himself. Peter Jenkins making the tackle.
Yeah, he's kind of like a physics lesson coming at you. As you said, he's not as tall, 5'11", 224. He's a small guy, but he's got speed and mass. And when it's coming at you, Timmy, in that kind of a package, he can really get plus yardage. But when you got a 5 or 6-man front run blitz, you can deny him that opportunity.
He's a true freshman. Not a bad idea to get running backs from Oklahoma and Georgia. When you're in the state of Iowa, they usually make a few good RBs in those states. As you see, Nashawn Hughes making the stop of Mike Warren right there for Texas.
When Nashawn really came down that line of scrimmage, hell-bent for election, man. He just showed you at 6'4", 232 from Harker Heights, he's got the ability to turn and pivot and then go and close and make a great tackle.
Third down and 10. The Horns defensively, Vance Bedford was talking, their defensive coordinator, about how much better a job they were doing in getting off the field on third down. A more difficult chore tonight because of Lanning. See what happens here.
See what they do against this single safety. Look here, it's going to be man and pressure fighting.
There he goes again. Tuck it and run. Why not? First down.
Timmy, what made that play work is, again, you had a single safety look. That meant you were likely to get pressure. Everybody's bailing out of there. That means if you're running playing, man, your back is to the quarterback. Lanning understands that. He pulled it down quicker than he normally would. He gets a tremendous play. Now it's time for pace and tempo.
Well, they've converted 2 third and longs on the legs of Joel Lanning. After the 14-yard gain by the quarterback, Mike Warren is tripped up at the line of scrimmage.
Todd Sturdy told us what constitutes a win for them is 4 yards on first down, and they're short of it there with 2 there, but that means they want to be in a position where they can run or throw and convince the defense that that is their intent.
Second and 9. Lanning goes with the out pattern. It's caught by Wesley.
Duke Thomas was covering on that one. That was just a laser in the dark to Wesley on the out route. Gave him protection. Lanning had everything he needed on that particular play. And that's the execution that Todd Sturdy is looking for out of his young quarterback.
Third down and 3. Very manageable. Exactly what Todd Sturdy, the offensive coordinator, for the first time this year, told us, as Spencer mentioned in our meetings yesterday. Rolling and throwing, and it's caught right at the 30 by Montgomery. No, they're going to rule it incomplete. It was short-hopped. And fourth down coming up. I believe he may have been down anyway when he actually went to the ground to pick it up, try to reel it in. Well, there's an old first baseman. I remember those.
Timmy, one of the things I'm noticing here as we look at that play, number one, it hit the ground and it's out anyway, but Malik Jefferson, number 46 for Texas, watch him, because Lanning has been so effective at pulling the ball down. They are running the ball, and he was concerned about his ability to improvise and score.
It is a fourth down. This time Lanning has stopped. Did not feel the backside pressure from Bryce Cottrell, 91.
Well, that's one thing that any quarterback must understand. If anybody's going away from you, you better know they're coming back. They're going to redirect. If the pressure is coming from this outside here or here, as a quarterback, you've got to know when they pass you at some point in time, once they redirect, Cottrell sheds and releases, he's going to come right back. So if you escape anywhere, you escape up the football field. That's really about awareness, and that's a lack of experience there on that particular play.
You don't mind the call, though, going for it on 4th and 3.
I think it was a great call. Fantastic call, because, again, the point I was going to make there was Malik Jefferson. They've assigned him to spy the quarterback. They're concerned about him getting those rushing yards.
On first down, Hurd, play action. Plenty of time, and that pass should have been picked. Tribune had a beat on it. That would have been 6. Boy, and he knows it.
Nigel had it in his gun sights. 5'11", 184-pound junior from Jacksonville, Florida. You know why they're going to Florida to get some of that speed and that athleticism, the ability to jump around. Man, he hits his head on the goalpost if he snags that one, Tim.
I mean, it would have been one man to beat Dajae Johnson back there, but he would have had a full head of steam bringing it down. Gray, a couple of yards maybe, but beyond the line of scrimmage. Jordan Harris, with the stop.
And Jordan Harris was filling. Well, I tell you, one thing about these Iowa State defenders, they are not afraid to hit you. They're young, they're aggressive, and they will stick you.
Third and eight. This capacity crowd will tell you how it goes.
Iowa State content to play a three-man front from a drop-back coverage and see if the quarterback can beat it and reap the zone.
Timeout taken. Cyclones take it with 21 ticks remaining here in the first quarter. Iowa State leading by 7 as we welcome you back. FS1 College Football presented by GEICO. With Spencer Tillman, Tim Brando, happy to have you with us. Third down and 8 after Wally Burnham got the quick timeout to get his defense lined up. Heard on a design run, wrestled down near the line of scrimmage. And it's Jordan Harris who's been all over the place during the early going.
Jordan Harris was active in the inside there. You saw him really dive in and make a nice stop on a crucial play. And tremendous athleticism there.
Very entertaining first quarter. Before 50,000 plus on Halloween night. They began with smoke on the water. You don't have a lot of water in the plains, but there's been a lot of smoking. The refurbishing of proud Jack Trice Stadium back in 2011 has made this a beautiful environment. It's the only stadium, Spencer, named in the FBS after an athlete that's of African-American descent. And it's an incredible story.
One of the most compelling stories I've ever been exposed to. As you said, the only FBS stadium to be named after an African-American athlete. 1923 was a poignant year and a set of circumstances that we need to unpack a little bit further, Tim. But I'll just put it this way. The compelling letter that he wrote 2 days before he would eventually lose his life as a result of an injury on the field. He initially diagnosed as a broken clavicle, yeah. But there was an internal hemorrhaging as well that he would later die from.
On the train coming back from Minnesota.
On the train coming back from Minnesota and playing that game. And he pinned that the day before in a segregated hotel room.
Amazing.
And they found it inside his pocket before the funeral. And it was one of the most moving moments and accounts that I've heard from Coach Paul Roos.
I'm sure a number of people have oftentimes wondered who exactly was Jack Trice. Normally it would be after a major donor, someone from the academic community, and here we have a one-of-a-kind story about an athlete that was way ahead of his time. Beautiful run from Mike Warren. Talk about waking up some echoes. At the running back position, this young man is making quite a mark, and I think you're surprised. You did not anticipate this against a stout front seven from Texas.
I really didn't. Again, I know the back end is a little bit immature and young, but that front four historically has always been the kind of front that will deny yardage, particularly from young players.
Warren again.
I'll give Paul Roode credit for this, Timmy. I remember back in the olden days, Barry Switzer wasn't afraid to go down in South Florida to bring up a George Buster Rhyme and play him when they were young freshmen. Paul has that same mindset. He can't attract those kids because of geographics, but the bottom line is he knows what to expect. When he finds that jewel, he's not afraid to set him in a situation where he can thrive.
Second down, we'll call it 7. Lanning loops one long. There was contact, and now the flag. Bundridge was the intended receiver, looked to be held up that time by Jason Hall, the free safety, the sophomore from Grand Prairie.
Thank you.
Jason Hall was back there in coverage.
Pass interference. Defense, number 9, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
But Devontae Davis was the one that got the fall. And I think what we're seeing here is they're picking on Devontae Davis, Timmy. Not afraid to match up with him against the double move. He doesn't really bite on it. He just sticks his arm out there and pushes him out of bounds. That's where you've got to feel the boundary and not impede the receiver's trek downfield.
Yeah, Hall was coming over to give help. Davis clearly the one that held number 9 as he was leaving the line of scrimmage. Trevor Ryan is coming to the game along with Joshua Thomas. They'll line up number 19 almost anywhere on the field to get him touches. It's Joshua Thomas hit initially behind the line of scrimmage. I think may have gotten back to the line.
Desmond Jackson was right there in his face, man, and he was quick as a hiccup and, again, trying to disrupt that front. And that's no quicker way that you can do that by to disrupt the execution of that interior offensive line as they try to work down the field.
Second down and nine. Better keep an eye on where number 19 is lining up when he's out there for Iowa State. Mix up on the pass pattern that time. An out and up was being run by Lazard, and a simple out was thrown by Lanning. Third down and nine.
One thing that's kind of developing that Lanning has seen a heavy dose of man coverage, so it's really going to be about communication and execution. Both the receiver and the quarterback have got to be on the same page in reading the coverage and the response by this Longhorn back end. You can see the single safety look as Paul Rhodes looks on there. This look right here tells you it's all about man coverage. You got to win individual battles.
Yeah, both of these defenses are inviting the opposing quarterbacks to throw it. The problem for Texas has been when the legs of Joel Lanning have gotten involved, as that time Jenkins brought the pressure and got the sack back at the 47-yard line of Iowa State.
Yeah, Jake Campos, number 67, and then Jamison Mackay was out there as well and got to navigate around those guys and avoid him running to his own men.
Dajay Johnson is back deep. He's standing at about the 13. Downing will punt it away. Beautiful high punt. Fielded at the 6 by Johnson, and he is popped immediately by Jawan Wesley. Wow, did he get all of him with that hit.
Timmy, that's all about special teams. You put them in your gun sight. Johnson, you want that? You got to take that with you, my friend, if you do.
Wow, what a hit. Seven nothing Iowa State. A reminder, huddle up with college football experts and live web chats all season. A new guest every week, the Edward Jones College Football Huddle on Fox Sports. As is often the case in college football, dueling numbers. That was actually Brian Peavy on the special teams, who also wears number 10 rather than Jawan Wesley that made that hit. And it was impactful. First down and 10 with the ball at the 6. Chris Warren, number 25, is now in the backfield for the Longhorns, and he gets it. Ahead to about the 8-yard line. Cyclone defense all over the place. Kawan Floyd, number 7, senior from Los Angeles, coming off a hamstring pull, making the tackle.
Yeah, that was pressure, though, from everywhere in that Cyclone front. And again, I think this is the opportune time to do it when you got the Longhorns backed up. Wouldn't be surprised to see a little bit more pressure, but a two-safety look now. Four cross.
Parrott keeps it. Stepped out about a yard shy of the first down on his own that time. So it'll be third and a little less than a yard to go.
Yeah, John Floyd and company doing a nice job of pushing him out of bounds. You can see as he makes his way to the sideline, Floyd comes up. He doesn't really get a lay a hit on him, but he closes the distance between the sideline and himself to minimize the damage on that play.
The 18-wheeler is coming.
Yes, sir.
Our first look at Tyrone Swoops. We normally would see him inside or outside the other 10-yard line. We're going to call it third down and 2 rather than 1. Alex Della Torre, 36, the H-back, has also checked in. Yeah, just keep on rolling with the 18-wheeler. And give Charlie Strong a lot of credit keeping this young man engaged after having a difficult time trying to get a passing game going with him for the bulk of last season. And we have another injured Longhorn at the 15-yard line. But Swoops, to his credit, Spencer, you oftentimes talk about it. How does a competitor handle another man's success at his position? And he's handled it with aplomb.
He really has. And sometimes you don't have to listen to him. You can just watch his physical reaction. Charlie talked about that. And then when you look at Tyrone Swoops' numbers, it bears witness to the fact that he can be an efficient player and come in. You feed a guy the ball enough where he can get a desperate amount of touchdowns, I'll tell you what, he'll put a smile on his face, even though he's not taking every snap. Tyrone Swoops making it easy for him.
Played at a small school, as you see Della Torre, the H-back, who was shaken up being taken off the field. Played at a small AA school in Texas, and White Wright, Texas. And the physical specimen that he is means there's tremendous value to what Swoops can deliver, even if he can't be your starter. And they've really cashed in and kept him engaged as a player.
Well, I think
as a
made,
result.
Yeah, you made the analogy that reminds you of the old Chris Leak and Tim Tebow,
yeah.
The way they balance him out.
Difference being perhaps that Hurd is doing it more with his feet than maybe Chris Leak did it with the pass back in 2006. Swoops out to the 22. We mentioned that because Charlie Strong was on that staff with Urban Meyer at Florida defensively back in 2006. In fact, many thought that, and maybe even Charlie thought that his big head coaching job would be in the Sunshine State rather than the Lone Star State.
Well, Charlie, he earns everything he's got right now as the head coach. He was passed up twice, I recall, while he was at Florida back in the olden days, and then parlayed some of the success that he had with Urban Meyer into a head coaching job in Louisville. He's done a tremendous job wherever he's been.
Second and five. Andrew Beck, the tight end, 47, with Chris Warren in the backfield, and it Swoops. He is a load.
He really is. I mean, even on the previous play, man, he came in and just had a little nifty move. That shouldn't be able to be executed by a guy 6'4", 244 pounds. He is so nifty. If you think about Vince Young and put maybe 20 pounds on him more, the way he runs with the kind of progressiveness, he waits until the blocks develop, and then he exploits the opportunity up front.
Yeah, he's got a little more girth than Vince did.
Yeah, so I mean, put an extra pounds on him. And,
that's you know, right.
Vince is obviously fleet of foot.
Yeah,
put about 17, 20 more pounds on him. That's Vince Young, man.
This is a very deep Texas team. They've now gone to Warren as the setback, and they flip it out to young John Burt. And he's taken out at the 30-yard line. Let's go to Greg Wolf in Los Angeles for this Lowe's game break.
All right, Tim, thank you. In Memphis, the nation's third longest winning streak in early jeopardy. 16th ranked and undefeated Memphis. Down early to the green wave, Dontrell Hilliard, 43-yard touchdown, made it 13-0. Memphis has responded with a touchdown. 2-5, Tulane leads Memphis 13-7 in the second. Tim Spencer, back to you.
Beware once you start getting notoriety as a Group of Five conference member. Tulane giving it to Memphis early on. Thank you, Greg. That's Chris Warren out to the 35-yard line. Kawan Floyd made the tackle. Remember, Ole Miss winning today against Auburn. The more Ole Miss wins, the better it is for Memphis, provided they continue to win.
That's right, but Ole Miss looked like the Ole Miss of last year. Today struggling in the way that they did earlier in that contest, Timmy. You're right. They need them to stay strong. But I have a feeling that Justin Fuente will get his team ready, and the Tigers will respond in a way that's consistent with this coaching.
Third down and a yard to go here for the Horns. Just over 9 minutes to play in the first half. Swoops remains in at quarterback. Beck, the H-back. And he loads to the left for the 18-wheeler. He just keeps on churning past the 45 to the 47-yard line. Another first down.
Again, you see the ability just to feel it, how the guys are blocking up front here. But I want you to watch how he feels his way back through there and comes back underneath all of that. Man, that's intuitive and instinctive running. Slow to fast through, like old Edgerrin James in the NFL used to do. He had that ability to diagnose what's taking place, not in a hurry. He's a big quarterback, judicious in the way he navigates.
Four carries for 24 yards. Luke Knott made the stop. His brother Jake was a great player here at Iowa State. Yeah, it's really like the I formation back, only the quarterback is not dotting the I's, just taking it. That time Tribune got him. I thought Wally Burnham, you know, in our conversation with him, the defensive coordinator, said it best about Swoops.
Yeah, Tribune delivered the news on that one, man. He just raked and went right past the guy trying to block him. Made a tremendous play. That's the way they deliver the paper.
Going a quick screen out to John Burke. Most of the completions that you're going to see are those little screens and quick shovel passes on jet sweeps.
You talk about making plays in open space. Swoops is the victim of one right there. Again, that's just tremendous technique by Tribune closing on the elusive quarterback.
Hurd checks back in on third and five. More likely a passing down, play clock rolling.
We got a four-cross look here with no high safety.
Plenty of time on that play clock, down to five. Hurd, flushed, running out of real estate. Made a bad choice, and Harris has
gets the interception. First turnover of the game.
You can call it a coverage bad play. I was going to call it a coverage bad play, but that was a poor decision by the quarterback. Should have thrown that one out of coverage. Oh, mistake, Harris. Keep that one to yourself.
7-0 Iowa State. A reminder, the UFC returns to FS1, a full card of action headlined by what should be a wild rematch. Middleweight contenders Vitor Belfort and Dan Henderson. After splitting their first two bouts against one another, it all comes down to this. UFC Fight Night begins next Saturday, 7 Eastern on FS1, streaming live on Fox Sports Go.
Heavy hands Henderson. I'm digging him. I think he's the guy.
First and 10 after the first interception of the year for Harris. Fourth for Iowa State this year. And there goes Landon again. This kid is special.
He really is, and he almost looks like an old option quarterback moving the shoe on that play. It looked like one of the Texas defenders should have lost this shoe, but he's going to come off the field, but not before making an excellent read on the defensive end as he comes down and pulls that ball out of the pocket because of the crashing defensive end. Does a nice job of finishing the block as well downfield.
That means Sam Richardson does come in. Accomplished starter, as we mentioned. Will go down as one of the top three or four quarterbacks statistically in Iowa State history by the time he's done. Hands off to one. He'll be 2, maybe 3 yards shy of a first down. Lanning, 51 yards on 6 carries so far. And you see what he's done in the air to go with that.
I think for the most part, he's made some pretty wise decisions. He had a couple of errant passes on the first and then second drive. But since that time, he's kind of settled down a little bit. Done an excellent job on his end.
For the most part, he feels the pressure, too.
That's
not something young first-time starters always do. Quick out to Lazard, and he uses all of that 6-6 frame to get to the sticks for a first down. Devontae Davis, number 9, with the stop. He really wanted the first down, knew exactly where to go.
Sometimes, Tim, it's really about just want to. Like you said, Davis tried to bust it in there and break it up, but not before. An excellent game to move the ball upfield.
Trevor Ryan back into the game as Lazard gets a libation. Lanning with a pump fake. Again, he knew that Hassan Ridgeway was going to nail him. And he made sure that for ball security that time as number 98. Back after the injury, wrapped him up. Second down and 13 coming up.
Yeah, Devontae Davis had him in his gun sights, too. He was dogging and blitzing on that play, and Lanning just stepped right by him and let his momentum carry him past.
And there's De La Torre.
That's a big loss there now. He's their big back that they like to bring in, and H-back type.
Helps the 18-wheeler.
You bet.
Go with a safety valve on a screen that was well diagnosed. Staying at home brilliantly was Devontae Davis.
That's a great technique there by Davis. He's kind of had a mixed bag tonight. You know, out of position a couple of times, made some poor decisions in closing, but that was not one of them. Nice technician on that play to make an open field tackle. Yeah. You know, Tim, that's one of the things we don't see a great deal of these days. These guys don't have 20 hours a week to really do what they do, and they don't do a lot of practicing on open field tackling. So when you see it, it's kind of cool to see.
And even with the new concussion protocol, even if they do take the time, they don't do as much of it. Third and 16, Lanning. Oh, that ball may have been tipped. At the line of scrimmage, it falls incomplete. Fourth and long coming up.
Well, the exciting thing about it, if you're an Iowa State fan, is Lanning was making the right decision. The ball was tipped at the line of scrimmage, but he had a right notion against a zone coverage, and in an open receiver, the ball just didn't make it.
Holden Kramer, by the way, young man from West Des Moines, Iowa, completed a 22-yard pass on a fake punt against TCU in an opening drive that helped them to a 7-0 lead in that game against the Horned Frogs. So bear that in mind whenever he's back there. End-over-end boot, landing like a Callaway Mac Daddy wedge. Out of bounds, inside the 10 after a 37-yard boot. Mickelson loves to play that that lob wedge. That one landed just like it. We'll be right back. All right. right, Rob, a very busy day and evening for you guys in the studio. We look forward to that as Jonathan Gray sets sail. He has to pass the 10-yard line in the arms of Levi Peters. By the way, along the lines of Oklahoma State, again, I go back to this. Oklahoma getting all these accolades. They may be back. Guess what? Oklahoma State is undefeated, and everybody has to come to them.
That's
everybody
right.
that's in this conference that's in a position to win it has to come to Stillwater.
I don't think that Mike Gundy doesn't appreciate flying under the radar either.
Yeah. Second and six. Gray stopped after about a yard gain. That was a very big victory when you consider how Texas Tech plays at home with an outstanding offense of theirs. This Iowa State team, Spencer, has bracketed Hurd in such a manner that he's not been able to find room to break a big play.
I think part of it, Tim, is they've not been able to do what we use in the open, and that is establish their passing game with any degree of effectiveness, and that really keeps defenses honest.
Third down and five. Well, that one was almost picked off. Just outside the outstretched arms of Jay Jones, number 12.
Well, the pressure's coming from everywhere. Watch the pick to Demond Tucker. He's rolling, man, number 97, putting pressure on the quarterback everywhere. You saw it from the middle. Look at Big Parker, number 97, in his hip pocket, giving chase to the quarterback. And I'll tell you one thing about Iowa State. They are able to bring pressure inside because of the tenacity of their inside linebackers. But these guys up front are playing at a high level as well.
Ryan is back deep. The boot from Dixon. Fair catch called for at the 44-yard line. 44-yard boot. Homecoming Halloween in the heartland. I've always been kind of a flyover state guy. Spencer, I know you are too.
Oh, that's awful corny.
Yeah, we'll be right back. All right, which one of those guys is going as Larry the Cable Guy? We welcome you back as FS1 College Football is presented by Geico. Flannel cut off at the shoulders, really, on Halloween?
I like it, man.
I had to give Larry a little pub. Big Nebraska fan is Larry the Cable Guy. First down, Mike Warren in the backfield, and Mundry slipped as that pass was thrown. They're pitching a shutout, but it could be bigger, couldn't it?
Yeah, a sense of opportunity lost. First Nigel Tribune unable to deliver here on the mail on that particular missed opportunity. Janor Jones in the back end of that one missed it as well, high and away, right beyond his grasp. So unable to convert on those opportunities for the Cyclones.
Texas has been shut out at the half against both Notre Dame and TCU earlier this season. Means that they eventually lost, and there's Warren popping it again. And you saw that time he wanted to make a cut, and when he did, the feet came out from underneath him. Jason Hall will be credited with the tackle.
Well, as the crow flies, he's trying to get from point A to point B. He sees that opening really quickly, and he jumps in there. That's a great effort. Ford and company try to make a reach and effort to stop him, but too much speed there by the young freshman.
As we said, there was some rain here yesterday and overnight. That pass is incomplete at the feet of DeVario Montgomery. Second down and 10 coming up.
Now that's a third pass, though, that seems to be coming up short. Two of them were tipped, but again, you got to be able to complete those passes to keep the momentum going in this fast-paced tempo that they want to maintain. Trips formation up top. Look like they're going to go into the field. Nice.
You got to catch that one. Bundridge dropped it. And now Lanning, 8 of 20, but those drops are not helping.
You know, and Quentin had the wide field. I mean, they had a trips formation up top. He's got all this field to navigate down there. The 6'2", 298-pound freshman has got a senior, rather, to bring that in. He's got to be able to make that catch. Nice job. The eyes, no need to sell it the other direction. You got the wide field to work with. Lanning delivers it. He's about as confused as we are with the wide drop.
They need to take advantage of these field position opportunities. That part of the problem against TCU in a game that they controlled for 2.5 quarters.
Got your back check down.
Right on cue from your analyst. He goes to the check down. Alan Lazard to get it to the 38, 39-yard line. But there again, the no man's land of whether to go or not go. Too far out for a field goal try. And time winding down here in the second quarter. They're going to go for it. Paul Rhodes has made the decision.
I think it's Todd Sturdy's call. I think it's an excellent choice. You just have not been consistent. So they're not doing it with the kind of confidence that you need. If you complete the previous pass with conviction, then you've got Texas on their heels. They've either got to commit. Now you have an opportunity to win against man coverage. So, again, Todd Sturdy, not afraid to go after it. I think it's a good call. But the longer they wait, he may talk himself out of it.
They're going to take a timeout, it appears. Waiting until the last second on the play clock to do it. We'll have fourth down when we come back. Coming up on our State Farm Halftime, Rob Stone with Dave Wonstadt and Matt Leiner. We'll bring you up to speed on everything going on a very busy day. Oklahoma State with a remarkable win, and they'll document that for you. And Oklahoma had no problem in Lawrence this afternoon.
What do you think here? What will Sturdy dial up here on fourth and three and a half?
Well, first of all, you've had some pressure, but you've been able to navigate it. He's got trips. He's got a wide side of the field. Let me see what they do with the tight end here. Texas is going to line up with the safety to cover the hash, so I come to the field.
Yep. Going wide side, just as you documented, that pass is caught by Lazard, and it was a run-pass option.
RPOs are big-time plays, run-pass option, and we talked about it in the opening. Make them look the same so they have to defend all four options. If you're able to pass out of it, make them defend it. If you're able to run out of it, make them defend it. It's about selling it throughout the course of the game, and then when you see it in this context, they've got to honor it.
Ball at the 31-yard line. Warren nice. Inside the 25. Russell down at the 22 by Peter Jenkins, among others. By the way, when you say to the field,
that
means the wide side of the field, yeah. So the people at home know as you're making those pre-snap thoughts. Warren is down on one knee, and they did credit him with a 9-yard gain, so second and one coming up. But this is of great concern to the Iowa State faithful.
And what a significant part of this offense is here. Their leading rusher, he's got tremendous quickness. He's young. He's aggressive. Big enough. As you look at his numbers, they tell the story. I mean, the biggest run he had, the 63% .71 is a significant one right there. I mean, you look at all of these other great teams out here. Samaje Perine, he's ahead of him in terms of production and productivity. He's an elite runner.
Looks like he's going to be able to hopefully get back into the game. Just under 6 yards per tote, which is right about where he's been all season. 114 yards a game.
Yeah, he's averaging 6.6 yards.
Coming in, that's
coming
right.
In. That's a significant number.
Second and one. Lofting it in the corner. Incomplete. And it did appear as though Daly had gotten out of bounds and then tried to get back in. Yes, he was being covered there by Jason Hall and Holton Hill, number 5, the other cornerback.
Landing did a nice job of putting the ball up in the air, but as you said, before you even got to the end zone, the receiver went out of bounds and would have negated that play anyway.
Third down and one. Thomas bangs it in there and has the first down. Omenihu, number 90, Charles Omenihu made the stop. Freshman.
Joshua running with some conviction there. Again, 5'11", 224. This is a good place to run him often. Got a check down sweep.
Lanning, again, just with great effort, gets it down to the 15. That, with other guys, could have been a sack. Shiro Davis forced him out of the pocket with pressure. They haven't used that one timeout they have remaining just yet. Pass is incomplete. Going for the quick out pattern. For Juwan Wesley, number 10, Devontae Davis was over there providing the coverage.
Well, if you like your choice, into the boundary. When we say into the boundary, we're talking about the short side of the field. You look at his eyes, that's a great call, I think, because you know the clock is going to stop if it's incomplete. Save the timeout. Take another shot.
Another score here, even if it's 3, is important. And they've saved that timeout for the kicking team. Third down and 7 here. There's the shallow cross right at the line to make. Right at the 10 to Montgomery. And that should move the chains.
Montgomery could have kept coming because it was man coverage. But you're right. He turned it into a shallow crossing route. But he set it down and truncated it. Great decision.
They spike it. So it'll be second down and goal from the 10. Here's the conversion.
You can see inside. You can see the delay. He had a notion to continue on, but the read told him that he probably needed to set that ball down versus man coverage, but could have kept coming. He might have got a bigger play out
of
it.
You're right. He kind of turned it into a curl rather than a cross.
He really did. If he kept coming, he had the defender in his hip pocket.
Second and goal.
running out of time. Cannot give up a sack here. And does wisely get out of bounds. That could have been devastating. Desmond Jackson, big number 99 from Houston Westfield High, was in hot pursuit.
Yeah, and you got 6'1", 300 coming after you pretty aggressively. You got to get out of there in a hurry.
So they get one more shot at the end zone here with 15 seconds left. When you think about that height differential for guys like an Alan Lazard, Montgomery's also 6'6".
I like zone read and try to get the slot guy over the hash on a slant route. That's what I'm digging. There it is.
There it is. Bunker's had it and lost it. It was right there, and he rifled it through some defenders. The vision on that could not have been easy for Bundridge, but it was catchable.
Boy, he had it. And, you know, you can see it from this vantage point here. Bundridge should have hauled that ball in anyway, despite the tip, Timmy.
Yeah, that was tipped by Thomas, 21. Made it tougher.
Yeah, Duke got his hand on it, but you know that second, that's why you concentrate and do those tip drills. When you tip it one time, if it's still within your reach, you need to be able to pull that ball down. Great decision, great play, just missed on the execution. Duke, great defense.
Vance Bedford has to be happy with that. Netting 7-12 of the year with this field goal try. And he gets it to go. Yards on the field goal for Netton, and Paul Rhodes gets a two-score lead, one would think, going into the break.
It's points, Tim, but it could have been sweeter with the payoff, but Duke denies the opportunity in the end zone. Oh, so close.
Netton puts through the field goal. What was a very long drive. This is old-school football in a lot of ways. 16 plays that time for Iowa State. Took 2:59 off the clock, which basically leaves Texas with nothing to work with other than this kickoff. Paul Rhodes could not have designed it any better other than cashing in for six rather than settling for three. FS1 College Football is presented by GEICO. Dajay Johnson back deep.
You know, Dajay is an interesting story. When Charlie Strong first got here, he was one of the first guys he came to. Saw him in the weight room. Dajay had been suspended two previous times. A little short kick here, a little squibber.
Yep. And they'll jump on it at the 30-yard line with 3 seconds left.
And Charlie's really reclaimed his career, and he's been on the fast and narrow since that time. But he was really a problem child before he came, and Charlie got him in line. He's going to be a great contributor to this ball club.
Well, listen, all eyes on the eyes of Texas. And you look at Jay Norvell, the offensive coordinator, who had been at Oklahoma. Charlie Strong gave him the play-calling duties right after the TCU debacle. They decided to simplify things, and until tonight, it's been effective.
It really has, and I think so much of Jay Norvell. I believe, and this is my personal conviction, he should have been calling plays at Oklahoma a long time before he was unceremoniously dismissed, in my opinion.
Quick out pattern to the aforementioned Dajay Johnson. And on the final play of the half, he gets it out to the 49-yard line. Cyclones on homecoming have pitched a shutout against the favored Horns. And that's the third time this season Charlie's gone to the locker room with a goose egg. That's the story now. Now let's send you to Rob Stone in Los Angeles. Welcome back. FS1 College Football is presented by GEICO. Our score at halftime. Had to go there, sorry. 10-0. Cyclones leading the Longhorns on this Halloween evening. And you could say the goblin of all goblins has been Wally Burnham and his defense. They have really shut down Texas in that vaunted run game at their quarterback position.
They have, and the formula is really simple. They did it with effort and the timely pressure. And Wally's defense, really, they were all over the place. And again, Janoris Jones was active and early. Watch him just defeat the block here and get outside to make a wide open play. The zone read didn't confuse him at all. Jones again stopping him. And then Levi Peters, this guy was unbelievable, weaving through that front defense to make some plays at the point of attack. And again, you can see it
Jordan Harris was all over him. They denied this team only 98 yards to 223 for the first half. And that's pretty strong stuff there, man.
Brought to you by Lincoln Motor Company, our first half stats. And listen, if you can keep Hurd and Swoops from breaking contain, then you've done your job. And the Sage veteran, Wally Burnham, he's had to go up against all these spread attacks of late. Baylor, TCU, the hits keep on coming. I think this is a much more comfortable game for him to call as a defensive coordinator.
And ultimately, I think Texas may have a false impression of how good, in fact, the progress over the last two games actually have been. Remember, they had inclement weather, and the rain was a factor, and they had to kind of slow things down intentionally. And in talking to Jay Norvell, he says, look, we've thrown the ball well in practice, but, you know, if you don't do it in the game, for whatever reason, you're not quite sure. And clearly in this first half, they've not been handling that part of the game well.
That kick by Chris Francis got into the end zone for a touchback. Was almost about to go out of bounds before it went there, which would have given them far better field position. Look at that. They've only given up 72 yards, and that's saying something as many times as Texas is going to run it versus pass it. And then
those six first downs allowed in the first half, that's pretty significant as well. They basically made this Texas offense one-dimensional. Wally Durham's defense was really, really active, but I think, Tim, the difference is they played extremely smart as well. They tackled well in open field. They didn't make too many mistakes. Texas has bared the brunt of that.
Yeah, he went to the 3-4, and he says that's an easier base from which to recruit to Iowa State. They go with that, what is really a jet sweep, but will go down as passing yardage, and that is Roderick Bernard, wide receiver, coming over on what is in effect a pass, but is really a jet sweep action.
Yeah, you can see him there making a tremendous job there. Open field tackle. Even when you get a hat on a guy, sometimes it's enough. If you bring enough weight and pressure with you, it can be enough to knock him down, even though you don't wrap him up.
Warren and Gray, the setbacks that are flanking Jerod Hurd. And it's Jonathan Gray. You talk about meeting him at the point where the handoff took place. Damon Tucker. He's got the ability to be an edge guy, but right now he's snuffing it out from the middle.
It's Damon Tucker, man, 296 pounds, being disruptive up front, making his presence felt. He was chasing the quarterback earlier. That's a big boy.
That's a big ugly from Hazelhurst, Mississippi right there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you stay away from those guys. Third down and six. Nice cutback by Johnson. Daje trying to, but again, flying to the football. This Iowa State defense is like a cyclone. That was Cotton 23, the senior from Mount Pleasant, Iowa, cleaning up there. They've got them going east and west, not north and south.
It was all layers, too, Timmy. The back end covered and gave him absolutely a clear path to get to the quarterback and get to the run zone.
Dixon will punt it away. Ryan with the fair catch at the 40, sure-handed. Monday on FS1, Colin will welcome Donald Trump to the Hurd.
Wow.
Well, how about that? Most controversial man in politics meets the most fearless voice in sports talk, the Hurd with Colin. That's Monday at noon Eastern on FS1. If you miss it live, we'll have the Trump interview Monday night at 8 Eastern. Well, move over, Hannity. Sean is going to have to start fighting with the publicist for Donald.
Right.
You and I have had the honor of being on with Sean Hannity and Greta Van Susteren from time to time. Mike Warren was the fake, and Lanning takes it himself for a first down beyond midfield of the 49-yard line. Well, that was a great play fake.
It really was a great play. It got both of us right. You see Lanning pull that ball off. Once the defensive end crashed down, that's an easy read. It goes back to the old-school option game. I don't care how you paint it up. It's still the same thing, guys. You're reading one guy. If he commits and slams down, you pull it out and take it to the edge. Lanning did a fine job on that play.
First down and 10. Get him as many touches as they can. Wrestled down by Jason Hall, 31. Had a little bit of help to go with it. That kid from sophomore from Grand Prairie, Texas. Young man has delivered a number of big-time blows through the course of this season. Hard hitter in that secondary. Second and 7.
Joshua Thomas.
Inside the 45 to the 43.
You know, Joshua just pushing forward for a little bit of yardage there, but what's happening behind all of this is Texas is deploying more men around the line of scrimmage to contend with this rushing attack of the Cyclones. And again, it seems like they're being outmanned. These short little pops, 3, 4, 5 yards, are significant because they're moving the chains.
Well, they're doing it with speed, Spencer. You know, Todd Sturdy talked about that, just a quicker pace. That's, I think, something that Paul Rhodes really loved about the change they were making in this offense. 3rd and 4. And they're right through that A-gap, and it's a big, big host of horns to meet him. Malik Jefferson, talk about tremendous freshman. This kid from Mesquite, Texas, 5-star recruit.
Well, Malik Jefferson is a tremendous talent, but you can see on the inside here, you can watch the pressure. It's going to come from here. He's going to come from here and shut this play down. It's just a tremendous job of seeking where the pressure's coming, putting your hat on there, and denying the plus yardage upfield. Malik did a fantastic job of shutting that one down.
He is the top recruit of the Charlie Strong era to this point. 4th down and 2. Kramer to move it away. Dajay Johnson with a fair catch at the 11. 29-yard boot, but they got what they wanted. The ball inside the 20. We'll be back. 10-0 Iowa State with the lead. If you look at the Longhorns helmets tonight, you'll notice the letters FS on the back of those helmets in honor of All-America great Fred Steinmark, part of the 69 national championship team that played in the game of the century against Arkansas. A movie depicting his life is about to be released on Steinmark. And Aaron Eckhart, who's an outstanding actor, My All-American is the name of the movie. Aaron Eckhart will play Darryl Royal in it. Saw the trailer for it the other night. Just a remarkable story about a fantastic human being, Freddie Steinmark. Dajay Johnson takes the quick one and gets it out for a first down to the 23-yard line. Nigel Tribune makes the stop.
Timmy, to finish up that story, you know, Charlie Strong was so impressed with the scene, the story in the trailer. He actually previewed it some time ago. He made it mandatory for the incoming freshmen. They will be viewing it.
They did view it.
Yeah, they'll be viewing it again in the years moving forward to see it again.
Yeah, they got a private screening. And, I mean, let's face it, the Steinmark story about toughness is all about what Charlie's preaching.
Well, again, that's a narrative that won't change. And again, the millennial cohort, as we look at the down player on the field and Charlie looks on, this is what speaks to him. It's one of those situations where these players need examples of heroism.
One of the defensive front is down, number 91, Pierre Aka, junior from Indianapolis, Indiana, is down on the field. And that's why we have the pause. I remember as a 12-year-old, getting ready for that game in my hometown. And everyone remembers Cotton Spire from that team. But I remember visiting with Darryl Royal back in 1989 at a game that Vince Dooley and I were doing. And I said to him, wasn't that Randy Peschel that made that big catch? And I made a friend for life with Coach Royal because he said everybody forgot that it was Randy that made the big catch that led to what would be the winning score in a 15-14 victory against Frank Broyles' Arkansas team that had Bill Burnett, Chuck Dykus is a wide receiver.
You're going old school.
Oh boy.
Now.
Montgomery was the quarterback for them, and James Street was the quarterback for the Longhorns that year. Jonathan Gray is in the backfield. It's 1st and 10. Dajay Johnson, and he is in the arms of Brian Peavy, who's been everywhere tonight. It was Peavy that made that big hit, you'll recall, earlier.
Wesley was in that mix as well. Again, you can see again the pressure was there, but look at the proximity of the Cyclone defenders all around him, denying him the opportunity to get free. That's just great, sound, solid team defense pursuing and closing.
Let's see, you must have been about 5 years old maybe in 69?
I was but a wee tyke, my friend.
2nd and 13. Heard out of the pocket, but again, yeah, it's one option and tuck it with him, isn't it? I mean, he gets it out to the 26-yard line. Not a bad idea. Nigel Tribune makes the stop, but
Yeah, Tribune was there, but again, you saw pressure that fleshed him out. DeMond Tucker, once again, that reoccurring theme. These Cyclones are everywhere, Timmy. They're making life miserable for these quarterbacks of Texas. Heard and Sweeps, when he's come in, they have been present.
Our Halloween fun continues with Arizona and Washington later tonight on FS1, including a triple hitter. Add that to the USC-Cal game, and we had a quadplex of college football for you today on the Fox Family of Networks.
And that's the 44 receivers down here to the right side of the field.
Heard. See, this is an example of not allowing him to break contain. Right there.
There's just nothing there when he breaks outside. Brian Mills, 25, making the stop, the sophomore.
Yeah, Brian Mills was one of about six defenders to that wide side of the field who were in coverage but released when they saw the quarterback pull it down. And again, you can see Gerard Hurd doesn't really have much room to work with because of that swarming defense. Drives him out of bounds right beside Charlie Strong, who's looking for a place to hide too.
They have not completed really anything other than those jet sweep shovel passes tonight. Iowa State is loading up against the run.
Nice, nice.
Ryan with a lot of room, a lot of terrain. He's got great speed. Beautiful open field tackle by Dixon, the punter. And that saved, at the very least, a 60 or 70-yard return, maybe a touchdown. 53-yard boot, yeah, a 26-yard return.
I think that was Timothy Cole, number 30, that had a chance to do it. But as you look at the quarterback, there's been nowhere for Gerard Hurd to run. They've been swarming. And special teams. You know, I'm a big-time special teams guy.
Yes, you are.
Putting pressure on Dixon. You better make a tackle, man. Otherwise, I'm going to score.
Welcome back to FS1 College Football, presented by GEICO. With Spencer Tillman, Tim Rando. Cyclones with quality field position to open this series at their own 45. Joel Lanning has had an outstanding first start. Would love to cash in with this good field position.
Oh, they have a problem with the snap, and he's on top of it.
Out of that shotgun formation, I don't know if that ball did not get from the center to the quarterback. I don't think it never, it slipped on the grass for Locke. The senior, number 76, Council Bluffs, Iowa, could not get it off the ground.
Timmy, big picture thought here. Number 46, Malik Jefferson, the linebacker for Texas, has been moving around a great deal. They're trying to get this highly sought-after recruit a couple of years ago, the best in the nation, in a position to make plays.
Nice curl, and it's caught by Lazard.
Just sit right down, and he caught it.
Sometimes it's not rocket science. You find the void, sit it right down there. Lanning just placed that ball exactly where it needed to. Take a knee, young man, and it's a plus yardage.
Let's not have to worry about a third down conversion here, but Iowa State's done a nice job of converting on third downs and even third and longs in this game, largely because of the ad-lib ability of the quarterback. 3-15 in that category. Lanning, right as we mentioned it, gets it done on the ground again, ahead for at least 7 yards.
Lanning does a fine job of getting down. You can watch him here on the back end of this run. He's going to get down. You got a lot of big linemen. When you ride and mesh in the interior of that line, watch him. He just gets down underneath all of that pressure and that big heavy body. That's a good way to protect yourself.
Like that commercial with Kenny Rogers, you got to know when to fold
it. Right.
Yeah. Second and three. One. Just shy of the line to make, Malik Jefferson with the tackle.
And that doesn't look like a sexy play, but I can tell you it was an excellent read by Joel Lanning to leave it in the pocket for Warren to get that extra closeness to that line of scrimmage. And again, it's just wide decision making that he's demonstrating today. In the passing game, when they've asked him to do it, all of it. And Warren has paid it off, 82 rushing yards today. He has two more yards than Texas does in its entirety.
8-15 and third and short will help you in that conversion rate. Warren is the lone setback. Run blitz coming, and the perfect run against it to the left-hand side away from Jefferson. The right move to make, and it's a first down. And that's Nashawn Hughes, 40, making the stop.
Well, I can tell you, though, Texas has taken a beating up front from this massive front. Four or five, including the center lineman of the Cyclones. They are pushing this front four of Texas back.
Moyle, Locke, Daigle. Seen a good bit of Tyese as well. Burton was out of the game injured. They have held up beautifully. That pass was dangerous. And a marker comes down late.
Devontae Davis, they've been picking on him all night long, Timmy. They really have. And again, it's one of those challenges. If you're going to play with your back to the quarterback, you better play with integrity, because to the wide side of the field, that line judge and that side judge has nobody else to look to.
Defense, number 9. Penalty of enforced. Spot a foul. Automatic first down.
You can see Ponte gets that hand in there. And again, probably the major part of that infraction happened with the left hand before that, but great job of getting the point of him being alone on an island out there. There's nowhere to hide, man.
From the 23, first and 10.
That's got power look here.
One. Oh, he was hog-tied at the 20. And Rhodes is upset because he felt that was a clothesline by Jefferson. He is really giving it to the side judge.
Yeah, Duke Thomas was in there as well, and Coach Rhodes doesn't really like that a lot. And it looked more wicked than it probably was, but you're going to see he gets that hand, that right hand, and he does get the face mask, man. And that's Jefferson around the neck. Well, it's not there quite. It looked nasty more than it did. But that was Malik Jefferson trying to make a play from that inside linebacker position.
You know, I think it was a good no call.
Yeah. It just looked bad because he got folded up and put the hand around the neck.
It did.
A little drama there.
Yeah, second and 6. I guess maybe some would want to debate whether it was a horse collar. I don't think so. Had no mask, really had no shoulder pad. But Mike Pereira is back in our studios in Los Angeles, and he'll clear up any debate. Mike?
Yeah, we looked at it really closely, as a matter of fact. And you know, started from the front, so it can't be a horse collar, and he didn't get the mask, and it wasn't really a wind up and deliver a blow. So even though it looks so bad, it's really a legal tackle.
Yeah, and by the way, when you're that strong with one arm, it can look that tough. You know, it really can.
Yeah.
Well, it's great to hear from Mike, a difference maker for our coverage all day long. You've had a long day of it this afternoon and well into tonight, going into our NFL Sunday. Jefferson is the man that's down, as it turns out. We'll check on him when we return. The good news is that Malik Jefferson, once getting to the sidelines, is up on his own power and seems to be engaged and ready to get back in there when the opportunity is presented.
Tim, and they can ill afford to lose him. Malik Jefferson is truly, you know, in this age we talk about 3 and 4 and 5 star, he is a legitimate 5-star athlete. Freakish size and speed combination makes him, in this kind of hybrid world that we're in, where you got to be able to cover, he can stay on the field every single down to be a difference maker.
Third down and 6. Warren is the long setback again. Lanning looking into the end zone.
He beat Holton Hill hanging over there in the corner, got him isolated on an island. And Daly was there to exploit the coverage, and it was a fantastic pitch and catch by both the quarterback and the receiver, reading the coverage and bending it to the corner for the score.
Lanning is now 13 of 29, 121 yards. That's the second catch for Dondre Daly. Go to the post with a corner and make it work. 17 to nothing. Cyclones in must-win mode tonight.
You talk about an engaged receiver, Daly here, showing you his intellectual capacity here. This is the post corner route that's going to emerge out of this, but watch his little hand signal here, alerting both the inside guy, that H, that you could have a possibility of a blitz. That will affect his route, but he sees that the blitz was picked up. He goes and continues his route to the post corner and converts for a touchdown. It's a heads-up job by Baby.
Johnson inside the 5, takes it. And really good field position, and this is a big series coming up. Let's get an update from Los Angeles. Greg Wolf. Greg.
All right, thanks. 15th ranked Michigan facing a Minnesota team whose head coach Jerry Kill retired earlier this week due to health concerns. Jabril Peppers, 6-yard touchdown run. Michigan trailed at halftime. They retake the lead 21-16 in the third. Tim, Spencer, back to you.
I got to tell you, that was one of the most emotional press conferences I've ever seen, and I've known Jerry Kill for such a long time, Spencer. We've spent a lot of time with him through the years. It's very sad to see that he had to face that this week after a couple of episodes before practice. As you see, Devontae Foreman carrying up to the 34-yard line. You talk about a great coach that did a lot with little. He's right up there with Bill Snyder, the job that he did, not just at Minnesota, but Northern Illinois as well.
And those are examples of courageous coaches. Again, into his own admission, he would say he probably stayed a little bit too long, but the bottom line is he was willing to fight to be an example for others who were dealing with similar situations. He's a great man. Forget about coaching.
Coach Clay's his assistant, had navigated the position for him in the past when he had episodes with epilepsy, is now the interim head coach. Foreman gets it ahead before being tackled by Harris. Texas trying to go tempo here on third and four.
Yeah, the problem is, Timmy, they're not built for this. I mean, we know that they don't want to throw the ball. They want to be a team that plays from ahead, and that's not the case here. So this is a bit of a risk for Jay Norvell, the play caller.
Capability, but always bracketed. I mean, there are four different guys from the hash mark to the sideline. Damon Tucker will get credit for this, but Norvell's quarterback is boxed in. It's that simple.
Well, this is a coverage play here. Again, the back end all over the place, as you pointed out. But look at this little cloud-type coverage, and they'll roll it out into a single high safety look. A receiver falls down, but you mentioned it, Timmy. It was really Damon Tucker who's chasing the quarterback that puts him in a position where he has no option to even run it.
Trevor Ryan back deep. Dixon boots it away again. Ryan with a fair catch at the 10. That was a beautiful punt. So Iowa State is backed up. Tell you, the Longhorns at this stage need a defensive touchdown. That was a 56-yard boot. They need a special teams break or a turnover. Well, Fox Sports Supports is proud to team up with the November Foundation and their commitment to changing the face of men's health. Join us at moteam.co/fox-sport to learn more about how we are getting involved in the Movember movement.
I don't think the Cyclones are going to change up what they're doing necessarily, but this is the point where you've got a lead, and how do you protect it? Expect them to run more.
Quick wide receiver screen to DeVario Montgomery. Stop shy of the 15-yard line.
Don't be fooled. But some of these wide screens, if they're particularly the one-yard variety, they are looked and viewed upon as a short handoff. These are high-percentage plays the Cyclones are running now.
Second down at 6. Todd Sturdy in his first game calling as an offensive coordinator, stretching the width of the field and then the depth of the field. And there's Bundridge out for yet another first down. We've seen slippage tonight by a number of runners looking to make cuts. That was another one that time, but not until after a first down was gotten.
Bundridge got some help from his friends, though, out front blocking. You can see a couple of opportunities there where he gets to the boundary, but it's not before he gets some help from one of his friends there. That's Mike Warren.
And Alan Lazard also involved downfield blocking. Here's Warren. He gets ahead to about the 33-yard line. Peter Jenkins making the stop. And you watch the way this game has been developing, Spencer, and Vance Bedford's team needs to get a takeaway.
Well, here you got 2:17 left in the third. Again, this is a nightmare if you're trying to defend now. As they move the chains, that clock is ticking.
Warren again. Well, they twirl him around, and he winds up just a half yard shy of a first down. FS1 College Football is presented by Geico. Third down, we'll call it a yard. Maybe a little less than that as you look at Vance Bedford. His team, when you go back to the Notre Dame game, couldn't get off the field in that game. They had matured, gotten a lot better.
And that was the game that Charlie Strong made the offensive change.
That's right.
And again, it's defense that they're having issues with tonight.
Warren again. First down pop. I'll tell you what, this little guy's resilient. 6 foot, 200 pounder. The red shirt from Lawton, Oklahoma can take a hit.
The Hogs up front, Timmy. Look at them firing off on the ball. Working inside, trying to create some space in there for all of these running back. Warren, Joshua Thomas, all of them finding space because of the big ones paying the price up front.
This is his fifth 100-yard game now. He's up to 102 on 21 carries. Make it 22 carries. He may get over 150 if this keeps up.
You know, what was beautiful about that play, doesn't seem like a lot, but Shiro Davis out there, the big defensive end, the left end, just got stiff-armed by Warren. And Warren has given up a ton of weight for this guy, but he got four extra yards after the initial contact there.
I think it's pretty obvious that he's delivering blows as well when he's being hit. That's Shiro Davis, this senior from Woodlawn High School in my hometown, Shreveport, Louisiana, being tended to.
Big active guy too, 6'3", 256, and again, but Warren got to that corner and that edge and just jabbed him with that little stiff arm, man, and wore him down. You know, the reoccurring theme, when we talk to all these coaches, some of these guys, even the guys in these defensive end positions, they get worn down pretty quickly today. They'll come to practice one guy, and then two or three days later, they're a different personality. They're trying to get consistency from start to finish.
By the way, that high school, Woodlawn in Shreveport, not to be confused with Woodlawn in Birmingham, after the movie made after Tony Nathan, the great running back, went on to Alabama, that high school in Shreveport produced the likes of Terry Bradshaw, Joe Ferguson, and in basketball, Robert Parrish. Second and five. Warren again, he's just a machine. That should be another first down. Omenihu with the stop.
Folks there on Fort Sill in Lawton, Oklahoma, a little excited about this back, man. He's putting it to him.
114 tonight, and as we mentioned a moment ago, that's five 100-yard-plus games for this kid. And the clock winding down to end the third.
Wow.
Listen to this crowd. Cyclones came to play tonight. Homecoming in a must-win mode. All smiles. Things are looking beautiful in the heartland.
A little Neil Diamond, Sweet Caroline, as we come in to start the fourth quarter here in Ames, Iowa. Tim Brando along with Spencer Tillman. Bah, bah, bah.
That's what it's been with Lanning when he's had the ball. Bah, 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 for Joel Lanning with his legs tonight.
68 yards. He's been a great compliment to Warren, right?
Yeah.
With 114 now. They've got 82 to the Texas Longhorns. So you've got between those two of them the quarterback combination of Lanning and Warren. These Longhorns.
Well, that ball was tipped at the line of scrimmage and knocked down. There's a look at Joel getting it done with his legs tonight, Spencer.
Yeah, the beautiful thing, he keeps his eyes upfield. Watch, you see, he never brings his eyes down and even seats the ball in the outside hand. And then when he has to deliver it, he has the ball perfect, dropping a dime in there for the score. Boy, he is on fire tonight.
Second down and 10 from the 46 of Texas. Horns have got to get stops here. Between the sophomore Lanning and the freshman running back Warren, so oftentimes fans will attach stereotypes to teams with losing records, but we knew coming in that both of these teams were trending in the right direction.
They really were. And again, as you talked to Coach Rhodes, one of the things he talked about was the pain of having to endure the loss of Toledo and, of course, Iowa, the two wins that they needed to get to salvage things. They've got a long road to hoe. It's going to get tough. I mean, a couple of those top 10 teams that we see, top 15 down the road, they're yet to play.
Yeah, they should be 4-3
yes,
in his mind instead of 2-5. But this will go a long way in helping them if they can sustain this lead in the fourth quarter.
Lanning with time. Now he's running out.
And the Longhorns drag him down just behind the line of scrimmage. It's Nashawn Hughes, number 40, taking care of the defensive effort for Texas, and he gets up gingerly now.
Yeah, Hassan Ridgeway was in that group, too. They're just working with a four-man rush, gaming and moving around there. The problem with that is, from a defensive standpoint, if you vacate one space, Tim, you've got to fill that space with another body, and Lanning has done such a great job of pulling it down and running tonight. They're just, this is death by a thousand cuts, man. They're just really putting it to the Longhorns.
Kramer, young man from West Des Moines, Iowa, to boot it away. Dajay Johnson back deep. Texas has not had field position tonight either. They have been inside their 20 for many a series to start. That's a 30-yard boot, but again, very effective as the Longhorns will be operating on their patio yet again. A look at our Alberto beef jerky game summary, and the stats tell it all tonight. They really do, don't they?
330 yards there total for the Cyclones, and this Longhorn team had been running the football extremely well, especially over the last two games, amassing over 330 plus yards on the ground. But today, 120, man, that's amazing.
Tyrone Swoops has been called upon to play the position again, and unlike the normal 18-wheeler game plan, it's outside his own 10, not inside the Cyclones 10. They're going to have to air it out now. And like Gerard Hurd, it's about one or maybe two reads and then tuck it and run for Swoops.
Yeah, Wally Burnham's back in now. All they're doing is just playing zone. They're just rushing three guys on that last play, and they're going to do the same thing now. They're dropping eight as many. I wouldn't be shocked sometimes if they bail one of those guys out in the middle and just rush two.
Texas has started inside their 15 four times tonight out of 10 offensive series. He's looking long this time for Burt. A 50-50 ball that he cannot come down with, and Brian Peavy was right there with him, number 10.
Brian Peavy did an excellent job of turning and locating. He knows he's on an island. It's a big, deep ball, and he plays it just like a defender should. Those eyes locating it. So many times you see guys who are playing man coverage won't turn around until the last minute. That's a great job of defending there.
Burt is a big-time prospect at wide receiver, freshman from Lincoln High School in Tallahassee. Third and eight. Average starting location for Texas tonight, their own 21-yard line. They've been backed up all evening and bracketed up by Wally Burnham's D. That's a good out pattern that's going to be ruled out of bounds. They're going to say he was out at the 32-yard line. Peavy was over there to provide the coverage, but he could not bring it in. That's Lorenzo Joe, number 5. The receiver that did bring it in, but well out of bounds.
Brian Peavy playing with great confidence, not afraid to be alone by himself to the wide side of the field. Short side that time, but again, he's playing with great confidence.
Alan Lazard is back deep. Iowa State again will get quality field position after this punt formation. Dixon with another beauty. I mean, and with the roll, he'll get that one inside the 30-yard line. As Trevor Ryan lets it stop after 57-yard boot. We've got a flag down. Late flag. A late flag back at the 47-yard line. I'll have to check that out, so don't go away. We won't either. Flag was very late after the ball had already been ruled dead at the 28-yard line. So a post-play foul committed. Well, this has been a relatively penalty-free game. Cleanly played by both teams. Dan Romeo is our referee.
After the play was over, personal foul. Iowa State, number 26. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
Oh, Bonecci is guilty. That's a big penalty. Paul Rhodes not happy about it either. It came awfully late. Well, the penalty, which is going to back up Iowa State. Brian Bonacci, we should mention, this is a youngster from South Lake, Texas, Carroll High School. So a little something-something maybe on his mind playing the Big Horns from down in Austin. he got his name called out, and maybe for the wrong reason, but it felt good, I'm thinking, based on his demeanor along the sidelines.
I had a lot of good pro coaches. One of them was Jerry Glanville. He'd tell you, you need to put a couple of bricks in your backside, man. That was just a love tap. Man, yeah. He got knocked off his feet.
First and 10 from the 15 for the Cyclones. A very big punt, though, when you think about it, to go along with a penalty. That's a field position changer as Jason Hall rocks Mike Warren's world a little bit, going out of bounds, and we've got a late flag again.
The flag withstanding, Texas has got to be concerned about how this game is ending. All the positive strides that they've made coming into this on the defensive side of the ball in particular has been sucking right out of them by this Cyclone offense.
How many times do we say it's all about matchups in the college game today? And Charlie Strong's team, when matched up against some clubs, can play the pounded ground.
By both teams. Single block below the waist. Number 72 with the offense. That'll be a 15-yard penalty. Still first down. After the play was over, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 31 of the defense. That will be a 15-yard penalty, first down. That is number 31's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul of the game.
So Daigle, 72, the right tackle, and Hall, the free safety, are guilty of overly chippiness along the sidelines there, back and forth. Yeah, Jason Hall.
Yeah, Jason probably was talking a little bit too and stalking the guy. When you're pursuing someone that you may have just hit, believe me, those officials are looking at body language, but they're also looking at what you're saying too. And there's a lot of jabbing going on down there. We know it. We see it happen all the time. Texas got to be concerned about a lot of things, Timmy. You, to your point about matchups, it is a game of matchups, no question, in this spread era. But in a situation like this, about two teams who are trying to identify themselves with power running games,
yeah,
it's about the will.
Right.
The will to stop them in the case of Texas and the will to try to not be stopped if you're Iowa.
So after the 15-yard penalty on the punt, Texas surrenders it back with their mouths, in essence, as Warren gets ahead for about 9 yards on that carry. He is just shot out of a cannon, this kid. Yeah, Anthony Wheeler made the stop.
And Anthony Wheeler got taken for a ride there. Again, after the contact, you got an additional 4 yards. So, again, Anthony Wheeler was playing assignment at that will linebacker position, but got taken for a ride there, did number 45.
Second and two after the gain of 8. Joel Lanning, what a debut he's had as a starting quarterback for the first time. Warren, nothing there that time, decided to think better of it and get down. No gain. Eric Roberson, 49, redshirt freshman, San Antonio with a stop. There's a big third down and short coming up now because Texas is running out of time. They are down by 3 scores. And with the way this game is going, a 17-0 lead feels like 30-0.
You got a lot of room here to move the pocket to the field side. That is the wide side over here. I think that's what they'll do. They're going to the short side.
No, they crossed him up. And it's caught. That's Montgomery again. Using that size, Spencer, in down and distance situations with both Lazard at 6'6", 6'5", and Montgomery goes at that length too. Todd Sturdy calling up the right plays at the right time tonight in his inaugural showing as offensive coordinator.
And both of them are pretty good size too. Montgomery's about 213, as you mentioned, from Winter Park, Florida. So two big targets on the perimeter. Little teacup formation here. How about that?
Pass intended for Bundridge. Incomplete. Holton Hill was there to provide coverage.
One of the big passes he did complete, which is a significant one off that zone read action. You can see the out to the short side of the field, moving the chains. And again, that's just nice pitching catch by Lanning. He's been really stellar tonight.
Yeah, he is certainly the future. And we got to hand it to the fans and this administration, too. Second and 10 as Warren takes it inside. He just won't go down easily, will he? Anthony Wheeler again making the stop. At most places, Spencer, think about it. You come in with a record of 31-51. Paul Rhodes at another school would never have seen the light of day tonight. Filbert there, the left tackle, is down on the field for Iowa State. You know, I think geography plays a role and also passion with this man. He understands that they're not getting it done. There are no moral victories for Paul Rhodes. This is a big one tonight for him, though. No one's ever going to apologize about beating Texas just because they have a losing record. Filbert, the tackle, in need of some accompaniment to the sidelines. A reminder, the Arizona Wildcats will take their high-powered offense. Rich Rod with Anu Solomon into Seattle to take on the Huskies. It's all right here on FS1. Firing up Petros Papadakis tonight for some late-night action on FS1. He is our do-everything talent when it comes to college football. Lanning under pressure again. It's back to about the original line of scrimmage.
How about the nifty footwork there by Lanning? A little phone booth move there. That's nice sifting through. And they're moving the chains just a little bit. But again, this Texas defense, Timmy, has really got to go back and evaluate themselves and what they're about from a will standpoint. Cyclones at their homes just showed them this is our territory.
I go back to that conversation we had with Paul Rhodes and what tonight meant to the program. I think the decisions he made earlier in the week with Mangino were difficult. This was a seminal moment for their season.
Well, he tonight. Told us as much, and he wrestled over the decision whether or not to do it, whether to wait and maybe try to manage the situation. And so he definitely toiled over it a long time.
Fair catch called by Dajay Johnson at the 17-yard line. And listen, they had a bit of an axe to grind after what happened here 2 years ago, the last time these two teams met. This, by the way, was not ruled a fumble. Was not ruled a fumble. And they also gave up a Hail Mary to close out the first half. Otherwise, Iowa State had that one in the bag. And
Timmy, there was another play that was controversial as well. There were two of them. That was just the one that was the most egregious in my estimation. But I'll tell you, they had that game won twice.
First and 10 for Texas. Swoops lets it fly. Wide open, a busted coverage, and Johnson, I believe, was out of bounds. Wow. I mean, there's not a defender on that busted coverage within 15 yards of the far hash mark. And he just had an errant throw.
John Floyd was the only guy. The strong safety was back there. I don't know how you missed that. But again, I think with that particular play becomes the benchmark. That's the play that defines why this Texas team has been struggling so much. Inability to execute in the passing game. And there's no way for them to come back if you can't throw that pass. I mean, that play has been set up for three quarters.
Now we talk about being one-dimensional, and they have been so scouted by Iowa State. They have only crossed the 50 one time tonight, and that happened in the second quarter, largely on the legs of Swoops when he came into the game for Gerard Hurd, who has really been
I mean, Timmy, look, there's nobody in between there. You know, again, when you set up the first three quarters, we used to do this in the old West Coast-style offense, you spend the first half setting up plays in formation to manipulate coverage, and they got what they were looking for. I mean, Floyd was about 14 yards away. That's incredible. And you miss a wide open man. That's tough.
Well, the other thing is that this whole approach that they had with regard to Swoops being the 18-wheeler and Hurd doing with his legs in effect what, as Charlie said, Chris Leak may have done with his
After
passing.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Incompleted pass.
And again, I don't know why you had to look at that. we could have told you that live. But reality is they've got to go back, understanding now with the rest of their season at hand and trying to become bowl eligible, that some changes are going to have to be made with regard to what they believe is their elixir for what ails them.
Yeah, and I think the difficult thing is that there have been so many changes. I mean, anytime you move two coaches that were calling plays for you, and before the season began, there were a couple of coaching moves as well. So Charlie has made some moves with personnel and coaches.
Lorenzo Joe, the recipient of that pass, gets it out to about the 24-yard line.
And let's give this Paul Rhodes team some credit, because again, you talk about the 12 years he's been here, either as an assistant or a head coach. He doesn't have the greatest tradition to work with, but he's got tremendous fans, as you pointed out, who will support them no matter what. This has been a very difficult year. Six teams that they face in the top 20, Timmy.
Deontay Foreman is in the backfield. Swoops on third and four. Rifles it. Thrown behind Dajay Johnson, incomplete. And it's fourth down coming up, and they'll be forced to punt again, and they're running out of time as the clock goes tick, tick, tick.
There's another example where, although the pressure was there,
catchable.
It was catchable. The quarterback had time to set his feet. The pocket was tight, but you got to pay that off.
It was a dart, but it was catchable. Trevor Ryan again is back deep for Iowa State. Oh, that's shot. And misery loves company, and that time Dixon got that one off the side of the foot. Iowa State will have it just inside their own 40-yard line. Joel Lanning, young man, is all smiles from Ankeny, Iowa. Good to be home on homecoming. FS1 College Football is presented by Geico. Tim Brando, Spencer Tillman, Jack Trice Stadium in Ames, Iowa, and a 17-0 shutout being thrown by the Cyclones. First down from their 40, we'll call it. And it's Warren.
Ames with a marker down. He will set sail, and no one will catch him. Only the holding call could catch that.
60 yards on the run, but it looks like it will be brought back.
Offense, number 78. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Wendell Tyese. Tyese just tackled him here.
You can see Tyese right here. Just gets the hand around him. And anytime you get beat like that, sometimes it's good to kind of limit the damage. But it was good to see the speed, man. Nobody's going to catch Warren. Did you see the burst that he had on the back end?
Oh, does he ever have a burst?
Good Lord.
So it's first down and 20. By the way, Texas has never scored less than 17 against Iowa State.
That's the thing you want to stay away from, those benchmark low marks, low water marks. And when you start seeing those kind of inflection points, people start to take reaches and say things that they typically wouldn't about, particularly a historic program like Texas.
Well, it was that performance against TCU that started all the chirping down in Austin. DeVario Montgomery making that catch. I think that's probably one of the real keys for Charlie, is to avoid those catastrophic performances so you can keep it. Oh, listen, there's a lot to be said about the size of this program and the microscope and glass house that you're in when you're in Austin versus Louisville, Kentucky, or a lot of other Division I jobs. Second and 14.
Thomas. And the truth is, with respect to Texas, Charlie Strong has done some major surgery on this team. I mean, he let nine players go.
Yes, he did.
That were just integral pieces to this team. It wasn't just passive guys. So, you know, again, but it's Texas. You're going to be expected to win no matter what. You're going to get the pick of the litter typically. You've got the ambient heat of A&M, TCU, now Baylor. All those teams are able to recruit at a high level. And so the job becomes very difficult to Texas.
Yeah, Darrell Royal did not have to deal with what Charlie Strong is having to deal with in his own state. Joshua Thomas, the lone setback, third down and 12. It's a different time.
Landing. Look at the time. Man. Look at this
and how he's able to buy more time and make that happen. To Lazard, first down.
Yeah, there are two things that's working on that play. Number one, in your living room, you're taking a shot at it. You can see Landing delivering this pass here. It's a laser. A nice job. Lazard pulled. But it's really the protection is the story and the narrative on that play, Timmy. How long he had, and then whether or not Texas had the will to get to him with three or four rushers.
22-yard pickup. Statistically, this is a much larger blowout than 17 points. Warren again breaking tackles. Another first down. Timothy Cole makes the stop. Iowa State's never won in this stadium against the Longhorns. By the way, over 400 yards now for Iowa State offensively.
As Paul Rhodes looks on, Peter Jenkins, number 19, playing the Sam linebacker position. You know, had an opportunity to tackle, but he just didn't bring him down, Timmy. That's what I'm seeing. A lot of missed tackles on this, what could be a defining and final drive that puts the nail in this victory for Paul Rhodes and the Cyclones.
Just 128 yards by contrast for Texas. We said 17 felt like 30 to nothing with the way this game is going. It could get there before it's done. And there's Warren again to about the 25-yard line.
Warren moving the chains again. A nice little 4 or 5 yard gain there. Credit all of this offensive line and the entire staff for putting together a basic game plan, but one that was complemented by a very competent passing attack. And this is, you're watching balance in the strictest sense of the definition tonight. The Cyclones own this game.
Listen, this is a pretty proud, senior-oriented offensive front. It's a very experienced wide receiver core. And they're playing like it tonight. And then you got these young phenoms like Warren and Lanning making such a difference with their skill sets. Very wise. You see 1 second left on the play clock as he hands it off.
Timmy, I'll tell you another thing that Paul has done and at least embraced. There's a little group, a subgroup on this team called the WOPAs, the Walk-On Player Association, and Paul kind of embraces the idea. And the thumbnail of it is this. There was a group of guys in 2012 that weren't on scholarship and didn't really eat with the other players at the training table that was provided for the scholarship guys, and there was a mass walk-off. There were like five or six walk-ons that just left, and that was part of the reason why they didn't feel included. So they created this kind of group, a Walk-On Player Association that embraces those guys that are not on scholarship, and some of them are making key plays. Mitchell Hager, one of them, made a key play against TCU.
Just from the pocket again. Lanning's pass is caught. Inside the 10 is Dondre Daly. They are going for the jugular now. A 13-yard gain, and the clock continues to tick.
And you can see the spirit of that inclusion here. Everybody's still fighting down the stretch. Nice job of busting that zone open and getting an additional yard or two there with Daly.
Charlie Strong is finding out a lot, maybe some things that he didn't want to realize in the latter stages of this game.
Well, we said in the open that this is a game of discovery to some degree, that both teams are trying to define who they are. Texas thought they had turned the corner with a couple of back-to-back wins, and so maybe now they have to go back to the drawing board.
Warren. Maybe a yard, and that's about it. Anthony Wheeler with the tackle. It's not as if Iowa State hasn't had some success with outstanding quarterbacks in the past. There you see the numbers on Lanning tonight. Seneca Wallace made them a bowl team with Dan McCarney, going all the way back to the days of David Archer, later to be an Atlanta Falcon. He was a quarterback here at one time. Johnny Majors took them to a bowl game. They've only had in their history three bowl wins here at Iowa State.
And Paul's been here for one of them, and for his part, he's certainly contributed and to that lack of a winning tradition or legacy. I guess it was Johnny Majors.
That's right. The practice camp is named after him. Trevor Ryan gets it down to the one. You hear that crowd responding? They want more, don't they? It's not enough to get the win, that long-lasting win that you savor against Texas, but you want to get it in a profound way.
And Paul Rode knows that they're desperate for it. He talked about hitting the recruiting trail and going on the speaking to the Kiwanis clubs and the quarterback clubs, and he sees that desperate look in their face. They want it in the worst way, and they deserve it. They're loyal fans, and there's a core that understand the challenge from a geographic standpoint of what he's up against and how it's tough to recruit here. But if he can get him on campus, and he's working on some things to change that, Timmy. Talked about some rules internal.
Mm-hmm. It's not always a level playing field. He'll take the one tonight, though.
Oh, yeah.
Two minutes and 14 seconds remaining. Again, a reminder. We've got more college football action coming your way. Rob Stone and those guys, very busy. By the way, back in the studio, I know Dave Wonstadt's got to be happy for
his old friend.
His old friend, yeah. Paul Rhodes. He was his defensive coordinator at Pitt back in the day. He was with him at Pittsburgh, 2000 to 2007, when he rejoined Iowa State. Spoke very highly of Wani. And as he would say, as Dave would say, they have performed with a bang tonight at home. Thomas, touchdown! Amoyle, Campos, Locke, the big one, Spencer.
They're paying it off with Joshua Thomas, no doubting Thomas here on that play. He certainly is in for the score. And they're loving it here in Ames. With a redshirt Miss America.
Sixth rushing touchdown ties ISU's freshman record for Thomas. He's been busy in the red zone. Our friends at Ole Miss wouldn't mind you saying that. Yeah, why not? It's going to be a good Halloween party tonight. Ray Parker Jr. will be playing in a lot of locations surrounding Ames, Iowa. 24-0. And there's been a lot of busting going on tonight. No ghosts needed, as Iowa State has really taken it to Texas. You know, not many times do you talk in a college game about a team not getting past midfield more than one time And that's what's happened to Charlie's offense tonight. They have just been dominated. And Wally Burnham, the defensive coordinator for Iowa State, I mean, this was a picture-perfect performance by his team.
Defensively, they didn't really have to work that hard because Texas was one-dimensional for all night.
Ryan Newsom takes the kick. And he stopped at the 19-yard line. Well, here's the Dr. Pepper, one-of-a-kind play of the game.
Mr. Tillman talked to him. He did everything they asked of him. He was patient, had plenty of protection, dropped a dime in there on the score. On that particular play, just one of many he made tonight. And that is your play of the game.
Well, Dr. Pepper, one-of-a-kind play of the game. That young man's got a whale of a future.
He really does, and I think a point that also needs to be made is that Sam Richardson, the fifth-year senior, has been so accompanied with respect to that.
Lanning could have been a professional baseball player. One of those kids that, as you might expect, is super talented, played the outfield. Jonathan Gray took that check down pass, and it'll be second down and five coming up.
I mean, really, if you look at the numbers coming into the day, Richardson had over 1,400 yards passing, so the lion's share of what they've done to this point, he's responsible, but he had to take a seat because of it.
Beck actually making a catch that at the seam, Spencer. That's the first pass of that length we've seen tonight.
Well, it really is, and you wonder why it took him so long to do that. I think it's as a result of lack of confidence. And we clearly saw earlier in the game, Timmy, why, if you were a play caller, Jay Norvell, you would be reluctant to do it. You heard. Threw one into the waiting hands of the safety that had no position to make that catch.
Swoops decides to tuck it and run, gets to about the 45-yard line, just shy of the necessary yardage for the first down. You know Wally Burnham wants that shutout. Last one coming against Kansas back in 2013. They did, I believe, grant. No, they're still showing second down. Oh, now they just about to move the chains, it appears. Get them set, fellas. They want to go tempo. It is first and 10. Swoops again. Slides in safely at the 38-yard line, maybe the 37 of Iowa State.
While it was bringing pressure that time, they may want to go tempo, but they're going to make them pay for it. And again, with coverage, you got to find a way to affect the quarterback. And so they brought a little sneaky corner blitz over the slot guy.
Second and four. Nice. Over the middle again, and that one is caught by Dajay Johnson. Clock will stop with the ball down at the 23-yard line.
So finally, Texas getting some ball moving down the football field, but you know, where was this in the first half?
Yeah, a lot of it based on how many are rushing and how much prevent there is. There are some openings that Iowa State is clearly alive. There was a miscommunication and almost an interception. Tribune had it in his sights. And Marcus Johnson, number 7, became the defender. Well, we touched on how important this game was for Iowa State, given who they had to play, as you see the offensive player becoming the defender.
Marcus Johnson out of League City, Texas. Again, follow his career coming up. He's a very rangy athlete, but again, he's a receiver, not a defensive back. And again, the quarterback threw him into a scenario. Another mistake by Jerod Hurd.
Second and 10. Well, the 18-wheeler gets it to about the 20-yard line. And the timeout taken by Texas. Now that Iowa State schedule is going to be difficult, as you might imagine. At Oklahoma, Oklahoma State comes here. Kansas State, which is, we should mention, winless in the Big 12 for the first time in a while. And then at West Virginia. So it's going to be hard to get bowl eligible against that schedule. For the Horns, it really looked like they could run the table, that they might get to 8-4. Now they've got to rethink that, and they've got to go to West Virginia, and of course they close it out against Baylor. Everything in the Big 12 is backloaded because they wanted to have a game, at least some game, for the committee to see while championship games were being played in the Big 10, ACC, Pac-12 and SEC.
Well said, and I was looking at that schedule. Dana Holgorsen's team obviously lost, and then they were struggling a little bit in Texas Tech, coming up on the short end of OSU. So
we'll see what Stidham's got.
Chance.
I think Jarrett Stidham's got the goods to still be a quality quarterback in that system. We'll find out soon enough. Swoops, throwing for Burt, incomplete. A lot of jousting down there, but quality defense from Brian Peavy again.
Brian Peavy has been money all night long. They've tried to threaten him when he was to the field by himself. A 50-50 ball here. He's going to say, hey, that's mine. He denies the opportunity again. So great defensive play. John Burt denied on that play. Peavy, excellent play.
Well, this is for your shutout. And the fans are going for the jugular.
Just a three-man rush.
Swoops will run, and he'll get it to the five, but running out of time. Precious little time, and a quick timeout taken with five ticks left. Well, they have to reset it. Maybe not a timeout. They get the clock to stop after the first down, but would appear they'd take the timeout. They will. Crowd doesn't like it, but Jay Norvell does not want a shutout. And, oh, by the way, you're trying to find answers.
Absolutely. And, again, they thought they had some solutions coming in, again, with back-to-back wins and looking for more. This was one of those games that you just outlined that they thought they could win. Never did like being the guest on homecoming.
Oh, boy. By the way, we should mention our friend Spencer Tillman and his Oklahoma Sooners came in here in 1984, a team that would eventually win the national championship in 85. And were it not for you going skyward, it wasn't quite the Sam Bam Cunningham over the top skyward, but you did go skyward. And our friend Gary Bender, I believe, had the call back in the day for the touchdown to win it. The closing moments. All right, let's see what Texas can do. Final play of the game, one would think. Swoops to the corner. Incomplete. Johnson appeared to have it and lost it on the way down. The shutout is complete. History has been made. Iowa State at long last takes down mighty Texas. Pretty big defensive play, Spencer, since it preserved the shutout for Wally Burnham's defense.
Well, the defense played stellar all day long, but again, Texas themselves had a chance to score on that play, and they just didn't. Just dropped it in the end zone. Yeah. The ground can cause a fumble.
And Johnson had it and lost it. It was thrown right between the hands of the defender, Kawan Floyd. Our final score, 24-0 here at Jack Tri Stadium. Right now, let's go back to Los Angeles. Rob Stone and company. Rob, it's all yours.